Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. Nice to have you here. Just as a reminder, in terms of this, the level of this presentation, we're going to go pretty deep. So I just want to at least set that expectation with everyone to start off. So my name is Constantine Volms. I'm a solution architect with AWS.
And I'm Ben Masick, and I'm here representing Sony Media Cloud Services as well as Sony Solutions Engineering Group.
Thanks. So today we're going to be talking about containerizing video. And both Ben and I have a lot of experience going back decades in just creating and coding and putting together transcoding workflows, be that as part of a larger solution or as an individual standalone solution, like a product, if you will. But what we looked at here was the existing solutions that you may look at for transcoding usually serialize content. And then we try and scale it by assigning as many cores as we can to that. So we thought, with the advent of ECS and Docker, et cetera, becoming really interesting, what if we actually looked at this from the aspect of, would this be something that could be suitable for video transcoding, per se? And could it maybe give us some other benefits that we don't have to currently, or at least that we currently are pain points for us, such as scheduling algorithms, et cetera. So the way we put this together is we sort of thought it would be a good idea to do this almost like a system design, if you will. So we have a bit of context in terms of initial overview just to set those initial expectations. And then I'll hand it over to Ben for some of the business context around this. Does this really make sense to build something like this? Then we'll go into the actual design and architecture of the system. So which AWS components make sense for us to select to use to build the system? And then how will we actually go about architecting that on AWS in a fashion that is fairly simple, but yet can meet at least the use case that we're looking at here. And then after that, just to wrap up with some of the takeaways we had after putting this together. So in terms of the value proposition, what are we trying to solve here when we look at media transcoding? And there are two or three, or there are a handful of these. But essentially, the most important thing we're trying to solve is every second counts, and we need to transcode media as fast as possible. So wherever we can parallelize that, assign that to clusters, split it up, process it in a fashion where the content has adequate picture quality without impacting processing time too much, that's an important factor to consider. And then we know that things change. So for example, traditionally we would see new standards come out fairly, with a good timeline. So there'd be at least 5 or 6 years to put out a new hardware appliance in order to, process, say, MPEG-1 to MPEG-2, et cetera. But we're seeing now that that's rapidly accelerating. So the new codecs are changing. If you look at H.265, if you look at Thor, if you look at some of the open source alternatives as well, there's a lot of churn there in terms of those becoming available, but there's also a lot of churn in terms of deprecation of many codecs as well. So it's very hard to keep up with that with the traditional system. And then if we look at the combination of this high rate of change and trying to process content as fast as possible, we also know that the traditional model of building a transcoding workflow, given the nature of a lengthy time between new codecs coming out, we typically look at it that if we do a version 2 or version 3, we'll throw away all the infrastructure because it's been 5 or 6 years, and now it's a good idea for us to just rebuild everything. But if we're looking at this in the scale of, say, a year, for example, it doesn't become feasible anymore. So we at least don't want to dispose of infrastructure that would take a minimum of about 6 months to tool from the ground up. So that leads us to how can AWS actually help? And there are a couple things that are fairly obvious, and then there are a couple that, like I said, we looked at, you know, that maybe a novel use case, would this fit really well with it? So obviously S3 for a durable storage. So one of the tenets that we need here is to be able to ingest our content and have it available to whatever system we architect on top of that. So if you will, S3, Glacier, et cetera, provide us, you know, lifecycle policies, et cetera, to make our content available for processing, and also to act as a content lake, if you will. So we can store our mezzanine files there, et cetera. And then we also know with EC2, we have a lot of mechanisms around managing, scaling, auto-scaling, et cetera, different instance types and so forth. But being able to easily spin up and manage clusters and then assign workloads to this. And then if we look on the other end of the spectrum, you know, these new things that are maybe, they haven't really been used that much in this type of a workflow, or they've been used for fairly purpose-driven tasks in a workflow, say thumbnail creation, et cetera. How could we tie these into this type of a workflow to offload things like complexity? So Lambda is a good option here where you think about if I have a management layer and I need to generate thumbnails, I need to do PSNR analysis, et cetera, I can always build that into my code base, but what if I could compartmentalize that and actually offload that to, say, Lambda? That could mean potentially that my management layer could go from being a scalable fleet, because I need to handle a lot of capacity, to a fairly simple singleton type model. And then encapsulation, and this is both in terms of media as well as the actual code and logic, if you will. So could we utilize something like ECS to simplify the, at least simplify the entire system so that we no longer really have to look at managing the underlying infrastructure, having a lot of code to do that, et cetera. So essentially we offload most of our logic into, say, the Docker containers. So given that, you know, we looked at, let's build a solution for this. And we know that on the one hand, we have media. We have a number of services that we're going to look at using. Container seems like a really good idea, you know, on ECS, use it as some sort of an offload. And then as it is that we do it, you know, at AWS as solution architects, we help customers build a solution. And in some cases, we build solutions that, you know, our customers can then take away and implement or create derivatives of. But, you know, in part and parcel with this is we also want to utilize these managed services to our advantage. So for example, could we look at scheduling? Maybe we don't have to do that via code, and we could use ECS's scheduler to offload that, for example. Same with orchestration, deploying containers, is a lot easier than deploying code to a lot of instances. And in processing as well, you know, how would we split up the workload? Would we serialize it? Would we maybe chop up the files and then parallel task them? And those are the, you know, those are the core components that we'll be looking at here. So with that, I'm gonna hand it over to Ben for the, at least, you know, to discuss the business and the technical validation in this side. Thanks.
Thank you, Con. That was a tremendously helpful overview. And we're certainly very excited about learning more about containers and trying to figure out how it can help us optimize something that is so core to what it is we work on, which is transcoding. And we have entered a golden age for media productions. A lot of what we're seeing is just a tremendous growth in the amount of media that is being produced, that is being created. Many of the shows are actually creating an enormous amount of data. We're seeing upwards towards a petabyte of information, mostly of media, being generated for larger tentpole movies. A lot of this content ultimately needs to be transcoded along the way into one or several files. And so much of what is ushering in this new golden age has to do with the industrialization and mechanization of digital media workflows. Transcoding is so vital, so core to everything about digital media workflows. In the end, transcoding is ultimately what allows all of our workflows to move forward, whether we're talking about ingesting, ingress type workflows, whether we're talking about previewing, sharing, or collaboration. Workflows and digital media workflows ultimately are powered by this transcoding process. And as media technology professionals, a lot of our focus, a lot of our obsession is specifically on trying to accelerate, trying to speed up the rate at which we're transcoding, as well as reduce the cost to create these transcodes. And what we'll do real quick is we'll talk about some of the parameters, some of the factors that ultimately influence speed and cost. And on the speed side, Khan started alluding to this, so much of it has to do with the variability, the many different formats that we're working with. The more complex formats, for instance, with the more complex codecs, are just more difficult to initially encode, and I'm sorry, decode, and then re-encode after. Much of what we're also focused on is looking at things such as scene complexity. Once you've actually decoded your file, there's still a lot that goes into trying to figure out how to interpret that content and provide the best transcoded quality as possible. And then from a resolution perspective, we're looking at things such as the actual XY resolution, we're looking at 4K, we're looking at 8K, we're looking at things such as bitrate, we're looking at HDR, and all those many other things that have a very strong influence on the actual file sizes, and that directly influences the I/O capabilities that are going to be needed and the costs associated with that. On the cost side, as mentioned, we are dealing with just a tremendous growth in the amount of media that we're working on. Once again, we have a high degree of variability that also influences the types of transcoding that we're doing, and this will influence cost. And then ultimately, probably the biggest contributor to cost when we're transcoding has to do with the scalability. How much processing power do we want to apply to this fixed number of AWS EC2 units of work to actually get this job done? And so on the Sony Media Cloud Services side of things, we've been very obsessed with trying to optimize sort of this cost and speed type of equation. And much of what we've done is we've collected an enormous amount of information over the years. We have over thousands of data points that ultimately help us better understand how to correlate and how to better predict processing time versus other parameters. And much of what we found is that processing time primarily directly correlates to two things: the total runtime of the video, and secondly, the codec of that video. The correlation is actually so strong that in many cases we're actually getting R squares on the order of about 0.97 and beyond in terms of regression and fit. So the metrics ultimately break down to what you have here. I figure this was a highly advanced, Khan was telling me this was a very advanced 400 level, so I was at least going to throw up a couple equations. As you can tell, it's still pretty simple, right? Transcode speed ultimately equates to transcode time to some extent, and this, once again, is primarily dependent on TRT, the total runtime of your video. The codec, how complex is that codec? How difficult is it to decode? And then scene complexity. You know, are you talking about a scene that has explosions and a lot of rapid movement, or are you talking about face shots and that type of stuff? And on the cost side, as Khan mentioned earlier, a lot of the costs are directly correlated to the transcode time. And then along with that, we'll talk about how much scalability and how much processing you actually want to throw to accomplish those transcode time units. And these basic equations mostly hold true as long as you're working with some of the base assumptions we have right here, which is fixed server type. You're mainly here talking about just using a serial queue, and then you're also talking about single-threaded operations. But that's not all that much fun. And so as we move forward, what we'll see is that from a technologist perspective, we have very little control over some of the creative decisions surrounding runtime or scene complexity. codecs are usually religious decisions that are made oftentimes by creative types, and so we don't necessarily influence those as well. But what we can alter, the areas that we can influence, and this starts tying back into containers, into Lambda, and some of the stuff that Khan's going to be talking about, we can start focusing a little bit more of our energy on things such as determining how to parallelize for speed. How can we actually swarm, get a bunch of threads from maybe multiple nodes to actually apply and get a specific transcode job done? How can we optimize queue depth? How can we fully utilize these precious, expensive EC2 units that we're working with and using? And so containers really truly becomes one of the answers that can help us and many others in terms of trying to optimize a lot of these things. And a lot of what we see in terms of the potential, the future potential benefit of containers is going to be this ability for us to better manage how we're allocating CPU, these AWS CPU units, to an actual transcode job. And of course, we want to parallelize, we want to swarm where effective. We also want to make sure that we fully utilize the AWS units that we're using. And so a lot of the logic that goes into this is stuff that you can actually build out without containers, and we've been doing that for about 2 to 3 years, but we think that containers will actually help us get to the next level in terms of optimizing that much more out of what we're trying to do.
Thanks, Ben. So with that, I'll actually get into the system design. So how do we put all these components together, you know, what EC2 or what AWS managed services, et cetera, and configurations look interesting for building this type of solution. So we know from a high level, we need to create something that's pluggable with at least a source ingest, and that's typically mezzanine type files. And since we have the ability to basically cherry pick what we want to use for our solution here, we may as well use Ultra HD 4K P60 type source material. On the other hand, we're also, one of the things we want to be able to do is multi-format output. So we need to be able to do things like generate H.265, H.264, maybe adaptive bitrate derivatives, et cetera. Maybe transmuxing as part of that, which is less CPU intensive. How do we go about doing that? And then we may also look to new codecs that are coming out that maybe have skeleton code or code that is not really well fleshed out or completed yet. How can we easily move that onto our processing system and allow that to execute and then use metrics from that to determine when those codecs are finally released, how we would actually go about implementing them? So at least from the perspective here, we're talking about the utilizing containers for this. But before I actually get into that, at least the two ways to look at this, on the one side, we could serialize all the content across individual containers. So we could take individual mezzanine files and just assign them to containers. But with that model, we don't have a deterministic endpoint in terms of when those encodes will complete, because they have different types of scene complexities, motion vectors, et cetera, all these aspects that affect, no matter what the runtime is, how long the encode may take based on the complexity of the moving pictures within the media files. So it's not a deterministic measure, and that would mean that we would have to manage capacity all the time. So as jobs complete, we want to try and keep that cluster saturated. So now we're back to building a scheduler once again. So the other alternative mechanism is to look at, if we do a parallel implementation here, what if we took, given that we know the size of the cluster that we're assigning containers to, and the number of vCPUs across those EC2 instances assigned to the cluster, what if we split up the file maybe on GOP boundaries or similar type boundaries in a fashion where we could saturate the entire cluster and from there look at a deterministic endpoint for processing? So that means if we can do that and have a deterministic endpoint, then if we do this pre-processing, chopping up the media files, determining the weight of that against the cluster, assigning it to the cluster for transcode, it would start to open up those other business use cases. For example, now we can say, we can estimate the completion time for an encode, and before we fire it off, we can then hand it off to, say, business processes for determining cost and so forth. So that's the way we looked at this. Instead of serializing, we chose to look at it from the aspect of, could we parallelize, could we split this into a workload that is based on chunks and not serialized files. So with that, let's get a little deeper into what the components are here. And there are two, obviously the considerations, and this is looking at traditional types of systems. At least for transcoding, you have, on the one hand, architecture. And these are pretty common problems that we try to solve whenever building one of these. So how do we manage capacity? Are we doing monolithic processing versus parallel processing, for example? Do we want the system to be event or polling driven? So are we going to poll for new jobs and then process those as they come in? Or do we want to use functionality to have something else push those jobs around for us? And then there's some other aspects as well, such as HA, how are we going to handle queuing for the service, because there are obviously multiple components, et cetera. So we're looking to simplify, on the architecture side, all of these aspects. And then on the processing side, we're looking to do the same kind of thing. So how do we handle tenancy in terms of the encoders that run and the number of threads that they consume on a single instance? Do we run this in a serial or parallel fashion? Is it important for us to utilize CPU flags for any of the encodes? And some of these are already answered in effect. For example, CPU flags, if we utilize most encoders these days, we don't need a FPU in order to process the media. So we can map it pretty nicely as a thread gets mapped to a vCPU, for example. So given those considerations, there also we need to look at tool chain components in order to do the underlying layer of how we build this out. So there are a couple of things that we could look at for building this type of solution. And one of those is obviously, could we utilize a marketplace solution for this? But this doesn't really fit the model. It's not really a container type model. You're launching armies here. Maybe you have to deploy licenses, et cetera. So it's a design mismatch in this sense for this type of use case. But there's no reason that we couldn't use this for ancillary processing. The same with if we utilized Elastic Transcoder. But the benefit here is that we could use this for offline proxies, low resolution proxies, et cetera, for preview. And the nice thing is that we get fast integration and we get a wide variety of codec support as well. So you can think of these two solutions as being something where if you built a bigger type of solution, you could have these as ancillary paths for the media to flow to create additional derivatives. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we looked at what would we use as the underlying, say, code base, if you will. And we decided that we'd utilize FFmpeg, we'd utilize QPSNR for measurement, basically open source tools, so we don't have to manage deploying licenses, et cetera. So it's a very good fit. And allows us to build the system as we see fit without being beholden to any software that's running on it. And then, as I said before, at least around media formats, since it's been built from scratch, we can look at basically any type of format we want for an input. But the way the market is going now, at least for mezzanine files, et cetera, we thought it would be a good idea just to use 4KP60 as a type of a source to validate the design and use for a transcode source. So that gets us to, from the tool chain, to two additional components in terms of groupings of services that we utilize to actually build this out. So on the one side, there are core services, and these are pretty much required for the system to operate. And we can have some things obviously go down, but the worst that should happen is that maybe we have a delay in processing as systems come back online. For example, if they do a failover or if they go down for maintenance or some other reason. And here we have, at least on the storage side, we looked at what would the best mechanism be to map these chunks into the containers. So with EFS, since you're running you're attaching to EC2 instances, you can also combine it with ECS. So each one of the cluster instances that comes online on ECS can then automatically attach an EFS endpoint. So this allows us to do things like, in addition to linking those into the container images, we can also do things like offload if we move some of that content to S3 into Lambda. And here we can do things like include custom binaries for, say, PSNR or VQM or SSIM type measurement as pre or post processing, et cetera. And I, you know, at least the billing model here and the consumption model matches at least the unit of work we have, which is an individual chunk that may be, you know, 5, 6, 7, or 8 GOPS. So the files are pretty small. They can get processed pretty quickly. So that means it maps nicely to Lambda, for example. And then on the scheduling side, what could we do to offload scheduling there? So if we look at some of the API functionality that ECS gives us, being able to deterministically place those containers on different instances in a cluster, this looks pretty attractive from that point of view. And then on the processing side, since ECS is managing EC2 instances under the hood, and we're running containers on top of that, this is our main unit of work. But the nice thing here is that we can look at different EC2 instance types in order to customize them for different types of workloads. So for example, if you think of H.264 or H.265, they may have different sweet spots for the amount of threads to process, say, 4K media. We can then tune that unit of work so that we can fully saturate the number of cores on a specific instance, and then tune that to scale out horizontally since we're processing chunks instead of not single serialized files. So ancillary to this, there are also a number of services. And we talked about EFS, but there's also S3, right? So when the files arrive in terms of ingest and when they leave the system in terms of egress, we can have those be resident on S3 and potentially Glacier as well if we want long-term storage. And we can tie that into events to kickstart things like queues, et cetera. And that's how, that's how we looked at initially kicking off the system. We use a queuing mechanism based on S3 events to initialize every single transcode job. And that allows us to actually build that system without having to write any code per se. And then the queuing mechanism here, we obviously looked at a number of alternatives, and the obvious ones are a combination of SNS and SQS. And some of those we can tie into Lambda as well. But utilizing SQS allows us to poll for new events, which means that our management layer that we've decided to build on EC2, we can take offline for maintenance at any point in time. And we know that the queue of new jobs is just going to fill up. And when we bring that back online, it's simply going to empty out the queue and fire off the new jobs as it sees fit. So we can utilize this as a mechanism to control the depth in terms of maybe we have multiple ECS clusters. Maybe we do things like swim lanes, so we have different cluster types with different instances optimized for different codecs, for example. And then this layer also provides the initial explode and the final stitch of the content to get it back reconstituted into a single file. And then some of the other mechanisms we can use here as well is, for example, CloudFront. So we talked about, you could utilize Elastic Transcoder as a way to create proxies. Well, how would you actually serve those up? The easiest way to do that is to simply set up a CloudFront distribution and serve it through that. So those are the ancillary and core services. And then if we take a slightly closer look at the this notion that we have of a management layer, what does that look like? So if we look at a queuing mechanism on the input side, and a queuing mechanism on the output side. We know that with that, we can then look at having pre-processing and post-processing stages there. And that means that things like first pass pre-analysis of media, metadata extraction, quality control before we actually start jobs. If we slice up the file and then hand off those chunks to Lambda, we can utilize Lambda as a way to offload the capacity that is required for this management layer. So instead of having to have a large auto-scale group that scales up as we get, you know, many chunks and then scales back down, we're simply taking all of the chunks and firing up Lambda functions to process those. So it gives us ability to expand capacity without expanding infrastructure. And then on the post-processing side, we look to offload things like objective scene analysis or picture analysis or media analysis, such as PSNR, SSIM, VQM, et cetera. We can offload those things to Lambda as well, since we can encapsulate those binaries with a Lambda function. And then lastly, one nice thing we can do as well is, since transmuxing doesn't really incur any CPU overhead in terms of encode time, et cetera, or CPU load, we can actually offload that to Lambda as well. So the net result here is that we have a smaller singleton-type stateless model with driven by queues. It's non-blocking, which is pretty nice for this type of solution. And we've compartmentalized all of these other functions into Lambda functions per se. And then if you think back to how do we manage that from a DevOps perspective, it starts to make a lot more sense because individual groups can be building on the code base from existing functions. So let's look at the actual final architecture that we arrived at, and I'll just run through this pretty quickly. But essentially, we have a transcode layer. We have, like I said, a number of queues here on the input and output side. We have a management layer, and this is actually the same management layer on both sides. But the one thing to note here is that the very first thing that happens is we have a notion of a number of bootstrap files. And these are the container bootstrap files, the shell scripts that execute initially. And we basically do that by passing environment variables through the task definition for ECS and through the Docker config file. And we go off and fetch those that have been set when we schedule the task. Now, just to go through the flow, I'll get back to that in a second, but initially we upload content. We have an ingest trigger that happens and goes into a queue. The manager then first, before it actually splits up the content, looks at the cluster that it's assigned to. And based on metrics, it looks at the number of vCPUs, it looks at the number of containers, or sorry, cluster instances in terms of EC2 instances, and gets a bead on how many slots are available to basically utilize for transcode. And once it has that numeric value, it then takes that and splits up the content into a number of chunks to match that. And from that, we then fire up a number of Docker containers. Those then pull the bootstrap file that we've assigned, and that could be, say, H.265 encode, driven by a shell script. And those then pull the content, the chunks, off of EFS that's on the locally attached storage. They then transcode and then push it back onto EFS. And as each one completes, we put a message in a queue. Now, we can process this simply on the management side through simple cron tasks, right? So we have one that monitors the input queue, one that monitors the output queue. And on the output queue, we simply, every time we get a message in the queue, we check to see if our number of chunks that have completed match the number of input chunks. And once we arrive at that, we know we actually have, we've got a complete encode. Now, there's obviously a lot of additional logic around this, and that's a very simplistic view. But essentially, once we're done with that, we can then take all of the chunks and reconstitute, combine them back into a single media file with its elemental streams. So that's the general overview of the architecture. I'll take a walkthrough in terms of how we actually built this on top of AWS services. And the reason I did this is that the architecture at least shows the flow, it shows the components, But it doesn't show some of the things like how do we do auto-scaling groups? How do we match that? What were the decisions there? How did we go through that thought process? But essentially, on this side, in terms of the actual constructing the solution, right? We started with the auto-scale group, and we did this because we know we can utilize this with ECS. So that notion of deterministic compute capacity that we talked about, that we need to have in order to determine how many chunks to create and then deterministically process them by a specific end time versus serializing everything. This gives us a good way to do that, since we can simply set up an auto-scale group, assign instances to it, and then set the min-max desired flags to make it at a single fixed capacity. Now, the thing is, we can always go back and change this. We can do that programmatically through the console, et cetera. But at least the one thing here to note is that, obviously, the auto-scaling is launching instances, and we found that, you know, at least the one thing to bear in mind is that the number of vCPUs to match to transcode threads is important, but equally important is the amount of RAM that you have on each EC2 instance, per se. And the reason there is if we're doing 4K mezzanine files with a lot of pixel density, we actually have to buffer that up in order to transcode it. And then we have to hold part of that in terms of a seek ahead and look back buffer in memory if it's FFmpeg or processing H.265, for example. But that's important. So there's always that factor of each one of the vCPUs is going to have an overhead of about 1.5 to 2.5 megs. So it's an important thing to bear in mind, and it usually means you have to select instance type based not only on the number of threads, but the number of, at least, or the amount of RAM sometimes is a multiple of the threads. And then the other thing we looked at, just in terms of, you know, what are the other things needed to construct this when we actually initialize the system? And this is fairly straightforward. So the underlying EC2 instances that are attached to the ECS client don't really have much logic in them. We hand that off to Docker. But we bring these up with, we figure out looking at the instance metadata, what the local availability zone is for that particular instance for EFS, and simply attach that. So we match up the AZ, obviously, to the AZ that the autoscale group has launched that EC2 instance in. And then all the other magic happens in terms of Docker and Lambda. Now, the one other thing we do here, obviously, is we set an environment variable. And by the way, this army is an ECS-specific army, and you can find those by searching for them as well. But we attach it by, obviously, setting a cluster that we want to attach this to, so that when we look at the ECS configuration, these instances in the autoscale group start appearing in that, and then we can assign work to it. And on the EFS side, this is pretty straightforward as well. But the benefits here and why we used this and how it matched up with our type of workflow is that we know we have these large mezzanine files, 120 gigs for a typical media file, for example. And we take those and split them up, but really what we're doing is we're processing those in a linear fashion. All of those types of aspects, they match very well with the type of workloads that ECS is, or at least EFS is designed to work with. And then on the actual scheduler side, we saw this is the unit of capacity that we're using here, and we know that the underlying tenant for ECS is basically this notion of a shared state optimistic concurrency model. But what we can do there is shared state is one thing that's not really important in our use case. But at least the optimistic concurrency is the more interesting part here. So we can say if we provide our own measure of capacity in terms of units that each one of these Docker containers will consume, say 10 CPU units, we could easily oversaturate any one of these container cluster instances. But it allows us to have full control over how we schedule things. So if you think back to those bootstrap files where we pass in a number of threads to consume, et cetera, we could use this metric as we know how many of these we can schedule on any one of these instances because we look at the number of vCPUs per instance. And we'll utilize, for example, start task to deterministically place individual containers on cluster instances using the ECS APIs. So this is a nice way to simplify things, but then drive all the logic of where to place these containers from our own code base. And just for what it's worth, you know, a lot of this can be done from the CLI, so you know, 10 or 15 lines of a bash script, and you can get this up and running. The one thing we can do as well is we can swim lane things. So what I mean by swim lane is we could have multiple queues and multiple clusters optimized with different instances, different bootstrap files to process different types of media that may be more or less CPU intensive. So this also brings us to Lambda. So we talked about the pre and post-processing, you know, how would we deal with that, et cetera. And really the takeaways here are that we're processing these chunks, but we may need to do things like utilize binaries, right? So for example, FFmpeg, QPSNR binaries, scene detection binaries, et cetera. And a nice thing with Lambda is that we can have a, say, Node.js code base in JavaScript, but also encapsulate a statically linked binary and then shell out and execute that. So the process there is that we have a very small shim layer, if you will, let's say written in Node.js code, and that basically shells out, executes command parameters to, say, FFmpeg or scenedet or any one of these other binary tools, which then generate a standard output that goes back into our processing layer, for example. So let's look at the container structure, you know, given the at least the construction of you know, AWS services that we put together. And there are two aspects to this. The one is obviously the structure of the containers, and the other one is what is the tool chain that we use to build these. So in terms of the construction, this is pretty straightforward. And there's a Dockerfile configuration here. There's also a snippet from you know, our ECS, how we bootstrap that by fetching the bootstrap command off of S3 using the CLI tools. But essentially what we did is we drive this by just a couple of environment variables that we overwrite when we do that start task on ECS. So we can set the number of threads for the bootstrap to utilize. We can assign it a fragment, and then we can assign it a job, which is the actual bootstrap file to use for processing. And basically through that, we have a very simple, almost a single container model instead of building multiple containers. The downside is that it can get fairly large. So pretty much a statically linked FFmpeg with a bunch of other tools that gets you at around the 420 meg mark for a single image. If you don't include things like the AWS CLI tools and instead you do, say, an HTTP GET to a bucket, which is also an option, then that saves you about 80 to 100 megabytes off of the final image that you create. It's not a big thing, but just to point out that there are ways to optimize that as well. So the way we set this up is we just had a default configuration and we override it, which means if we include a single chunk as, say, a dev test chunk inside of the container, and we don't pass in any at least environment variables, we can easily just iterate against that for dev test by simply launching that container and then monitoring how long it takes to process that generic chunk, if you will. So the container pipeline, we tried to keep this pretty simple and just use common off-the-shelf tools as well. A MacBook, for example, Kitematic, et cetera. These are all fairly simple options, and they actually work pretty well for this type of a use case, given that we're really just building one single Docker container and then making it multi-purpose per se. The one thing that that could introduce complexity here is when you look at the binaries to include. And that's typically, you know, if you're utilizing something custom, you may have a chroot environment and some mechanism to build that, but then package a static binary as per the previous slide where we just downloaded those binaries off a, you know, via wget, for example. So that may be another alternative to look at. And then the last thing here, at least to point out, is that you know, as these union file system layers inside of your container, your Docker image grow, you know, maybe you have multiple binaries, et cetera. Maybe you have other dependencies you're installing, and you have a whole bunch of run lines in your Docker file. You'd want to do something to squash that, and there are a number of tools that will basically compress your union file system layers to make that image smaller. And then just to look at the process, you know, we generated the containers on the desktop, pushed that to Docker Hub, and then pushed that across to ECS. Alternative mechanisms, you could use GitHub, for example. You could use a private or trusted registry. A lot of these options, or at least pretty much all of these options, are available, you know, to configure with custom authentication, et cetera, through ECS. So these are all viable options when actually building the containers that we use. So given all of those aspects, you know, and the system that we put together, how do we actually look at validating this in terms of picture quality? Does it meet the needs in terms of processing speed, et cetera? So we looked at this from a couple of different angles, right? And we know that video characteristics obviously drive or are a large factor in how we actually spend time computing and encoding the media. So scene complexity, scene detection, motion estimation, bitrate and resolution, as Ben touched on as well. These are all drivers, at least that drive the CPU side of the equation for media processing. And we took some of this and we looked at this going back to that serial versus parallel model. What would this look like from a serial perspective of processing a specific piece of media versus chunking that up and then optimizing the utilization? And we ran a couple of, you know, simultaneous tests, and this is in no way you know, a definitive result, because there are a lot of aspects here, such as we utilize H.264, we utilize the constant quality rate, et cetera. Now, that could change, that could swing the other direction if you did a, you know, if you utilize different codecs, et cetera. But we basically took, and the graphs in the bottom basically represent three different use cases. So you can see the blue is the user time, and that's the time that the actual encoder is eating up as it runs through each one of the transcodes. The idle time is in gray or white, and that's the system idle time, when obviously when nothing is going on. And then we also have system time that's measured in orange. And that's if we have any I/O issues or conflicts or, you know, anything that impacts the system in terms of the kernel, et cetera, you know, that's where we'll see any types of upticks there in terms of that type of statistic. So for serial processing, the interesting thing here is that if you do process your media one after the next with a statically linked binary, that's definitely a way you could look at processing it, just by simply utilizing all the threads you could on an instance. But we found that there's obviously spin-up time and shutdown time every time you fire up the encoder. So, you know, if you use a statically linked binary and you have a lot of dependencies in there, it's loading all of those modules, it's setting up the decoder to feed the encoder, it's spinning up the buffer, etc. And you can see every time a new file starts up, those four chunks that we did, there's a shutdown period and a startup period, which is interesting, but it gives us, you know, there's obviously a differential there in terms of idle time that we'd want to try and eliminate. Now, we took that and we thought, well, what if we just, you know, parallel process this, and maybe we look at oversaturating or undersaturating. So, If we undersaturate, we're looking at, for example, one thread per FFmpeg encoder, say utilizing H.264. We found here that there were spikes in the system time. And this is mainly due to FFmpeg not being, not having a sweet spot for one thread. So if you have one main thread, and that thread also is then doing some processing for media, it's not particularly optimized for, say, H.264 encode, because that typically requires more threads. So you can see there's an uptick in the system time here. And comparing the two of these, you actually come out not quite as far ahead as you would doing serial processing. So we then thought, okay, this doesn't look like a good idea. What if we optimized the horizontal scaling? So the correct amount of threads, not over or under saturated on the cluster in terms of we're mapping exact vCPUs to the threads, and we're assigning the right amount of threads to each encode based on the codec sweet spot for the number of threads that they need to run and consume in order to encode the scenes. And we found that with the right amount, we actually came out a little ahead of serial processing in terms of time it takes to process media. So if you then multiply this out, a saving of, say, 8 seconds from a 2-minute or a 5-minute job, and you multiply that out by a factor of days or weeks, you now see there's a savings in terms of that can be measured in hours or entire encode jobs. And the point that I want to get across here is that all of these tests were done utilizing that, the cluster that we designed and put together with very little heavy lifting in terms of, not really rebuilding anything, just changing bootstrap files and firing things up again. And that's a little different from, what we'd have if we were building a traditional transcode workflow. Because a lot of these types of tests would actually be part of unit tests or the code base, et cetera. So the second thing is media quality. Now, how do we objectively measure this? And there are a number of well-known mechanisms to do this. So there's PSNR, there's structural similarity, index measurement, SSIM, there are VQM, there are a couple others as well. But these all equate to a binary. And the big thing here is that we can either look at serializing these in terms of as we finish a transcode, the same container then runs an objective quality measurement, or we could do it via Lambda. And the point here is in terms of the transcode time and the slide that Ben showed around that for statistics, in terms of measuring how we calculate how long it takes for a piece of media to encode, the benefit here is that we now know what is the objective picture quality that has been generated as a comparison to the actual source image. And this is very handy in that we can then utilize this to tune the system with a feedback loop, if you will, since these are all log files that get generated. And we can utilize this to tweak and tune the codec parameters in order to encode things faster at a better quality. So between the two of those are the two mechanisms to look at in terms of optimizing the system objectively. So what did we learn from this? A number of things, and some of these are pretty obvious. So decoupling the stack, we didn't really talk about spot or reserved instances, et cetera, but that's definitely an option here, and it's extremely suitable for these types of use cases, given the fact that we spin up these instances and then we assign capacity to them. So that maps very well to that spot type use case because it's per job type basis. We also learned that it's not very good to saturate even with Docker containers in terms of consuming too many vCPUs. So that was actually a bad idea, even though you can quite easily do it. It's better to align to a vCPU. We also saw that EFS actually provides a really good option to make the media available to all of the containers simultaneously. And then the encapsulation that we got with basically the only code base resides on the management layer and on the Docker container layer in terms of those bootstrap files. So that sort of gets us back to those first three questions, right? Speed is important. So given this type of a mechanism, not only on the processing side, but also the engineering side in terms of how complex is it to build this kind of system, it's pretty simple. The entire infrastructure takes about 15 minutes or so to set up by hand, if you're doing it that way. So that's important. And then as well as those other factors we talked about, right, not having to rewrite the code base all the time, keeping things the same, and simply modifying those bootstrap files to allow us to test new types of codecs, et cetera. So at the end of the day, you know, we found that this provides a really good alternative. It's maybe not the best solution across the board for all these types of you know, transcoding workflows, but in terms of next-gen codecs, et cetera, it's a very suitable solution, if you will, to be able to test and even build solutions on there for custom transcode workflows. And with that, thanks, everyone. There are a number of related sessions that are coming up as well. These are mostly on the M&E side, so anything media and entertainment related. I'll actually flip back to the slide afterwards. We'd appreciate this as well, and thanks a lot. I also have Jin in the back, and she has marketplace coupons, I believe. So if you would like to spin up transcoders or some such on top of marketplace, feel free to go to her and she'll give you some discount codes for that. Thanks.